Let's talk networking models, what they are, why they exist, and what they do for us in helping us understand how networks work. A couple objectives for this video. By the end, you should be able to explain why do networking models exist, what are they for, and what are the primary networking models that we deal with as we talk about networking. So the purpose of networking models, why do we have them? For one, it's a framework. A networking model is a framework for understanding how the pieces of a network fit together. Just like a globe is a framework for understanding the world. The globe is not the world, and the model is not the network. But it's a way to organize the pieces and help us see how things fit together, just like looking at a map on a globe helps us understand where the countries are in relationship to each other. It is also a way to outline the division of labor. So as you look through a network, you've got a whole bunch of responsibilities, a whole bunch of things that have to be done to make the network work. And the networking model helps you figure out what pieces fit where and what needs to be done at which stages and what may not need to be done at all. And finally, they make the protocols interchangeable by clearly having those divisions of labor that lets you set up protocols that work at each layer and can be interchangeable with each other. So more and more networks now are IP-based networks, internet protocol-based networks. But back in the good old days, there was IP, there was IPX, and there were AppleTalk and a dozen other protocols that worked on the network to make things work. And some of those are still around. But like I said, more and more now are IP-based networks. But those protocols are interchangeable because we have these models that explain what responsibilities fit where, and as long as you're doing your responsibilities at your layer, then you can make it work. And your protocol does what it needs to do. So in networking models, we have kind of semi-independent layers. I call them semi-independent because as we talk about how all the pieces fit together and everything, you're gonna realize that they're not as independent as it looks, or as we like to say they are, but these layers are independent of each other a little bit, mostly, and that makes them interchangeable, like I said before. So TCP and UDP are two different protocols that we'll talk about, and each of them is interchangeable with the other as long as it fits the needs of whatever application you're working on. So the original networking model is the OSI model, and it's created by the ISO, or the International Standards Organization, to organize the way networks work, and these pieces all fit together. So at the bottom, we've got the physical layer, and that we call layer one. And that represents physical things, hardware, wires, cables, things like that. And then above that, you've got data link layer two, networking and layer three, and then layers four through seven up above that. Now I point out specifically layer one, two, and three, because those are the ones you hear when you're talking about layers specifically, those are the ones you're gonna hear most often. Layer one devices, layer two devices, layer three devices. Above that, we're not talking about devices as much, we're talking about applications and things like that, so you don't hear about these top layers as much, but you're still gonna hear, and it's worth knowing what these different layers are. So I'm gonna confess a little bit of something to you. The OSI model is complicated, and for the most part, meaning me and all of the other people who decide networking things, have decided that it's a little bit overcomplicated. For example, one of the main complications is up here in the top layers. In the session and presentation and application layers, total guilty confession here, I've never figured out what the difference is between them and what responsibilities are done at each thing. And if you read about it in textbooks, read about it online, you're gonna see explanations. But in the end, you know what? We could just lump them all together. And so that's what they decided to do in what's called the TCP/IP or the internet model. And basically, it's just a simplification of all of the things, all of the layers that we had in OSI, collapse them down into just four. And all of those top three layers that I just told you, I never figured out what they do, that's all in one layer now. It's called the application layer. And the application layer handles application-y things. And so when we talk about what applications do and what HTTP does or what web browsers do, all of that happens at the application layer. And then we have the transport and the network or the internet layer. And those are interchangeable names. Sometimes you're gonna see it called the network layer. Sometimes I'll probably call it the network layer. Sometimes it's gonna be called the internet layer. And then finally at the bottom, you've got the link and the network interface layer. So this all kind of replaced the OSI model. You see the mapping between them, you see how they all fit together. And so, you know, as far as we're concerned, OSI model goes away. Who needs it? We've got this beautiful model, but the problem is we still like to talk about layer one, layer two, layer three. That language got into networking before we had the TCP/IP internet model. So the language of layer one, layer two, layer three stuck. And as a result, this, you know, beautiful four-layer model, well, layer one and layer two, if you remember, are down here. The network interface, the link layer, the physical layer, all that stuff. So we've had to kind of have a hybrid approach. So we've got this four-layer model that has these four layers, and that's great, but we also have the five-layer TCP/IP model. So it'd be good to be familiar with both of these. It's good to kind of know that they exist and know the names of the layers. But remember, if we're talking about layer one things, layer two things, layer three things, this is what we're talking about. We're not, when we talk about layer one, layer two, we're not talking about the link and the internet. We're talking about the physical and the data link layers. So when we talk about networking hardware, the layer one, layer two, layer three functionality is going to be referring to these layers. So often you'll hear me talk about the five-layer model and layer one, layer two, layer three, and not as much the four-layer model, because we I don't know. In my mind, it makes sense to keep them separate. And remember, these are models. These are models to help us understand what goes on in here and a way to talk about it and a way to talk about how these pieces fit together. It's not an exact representation of everything that you need, everything that happens on a network. So that's where that comes from. That is the TCP/IP model. Worth remembering what those layers are, worth remembering the OSI model. So before we go, I want you to do a little bit of mental checks. What have you learned here? We've learned how many layers are there in the OSI model. I'm not gonna tell you. If you forgot, go back and check again. And finally, what are the layers of the four and the five layer TCP/IP models? Like I said, both of these we're gonna talk about, you're gonna hear about, so it's worth knowing what both of those are. And that is what network models is all about.